Welcome to New Hope Church. It's good to have, did I turn it on? Okay, I put it on, I just didn't turn it on.
Okay, am I turned on now? Yeah, don't go there. All right, just don't go there. All right, good morning. Welcome to New Hope Church. Great to have you with us on Mother's Day today. If this is your first time here, you're a guest of New Hope. What a privilege and honor for you to come and share this day with us. There are some communication cards in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to fill one out. Let us know about your visit today. We promise not to come bang on your door or harass you on a phone, but through the mail, we're going to send you a packet of information that tells you about our church, what we believe, the kind of ministries that go on here, how you can be involved at the point that you would like to get involved. And if we don't give you enough information and you need harassment, let us know and we'll accommodate you. But we would love to get this information in your hands. Thanks for being here. Let me highlight a few announcements and then some prayer requests. Actually, there's several announcements today since it's Mother's Day. When there is a table set up outside. I don't know if it's on the front porch or in the pavilion, but there's a table of corsages out there, all right? Beautiful orchids. It says, thanks, Mom, for life. And we share in this every single year. It's the Right to Life Ministry here in Central California. Help to provide education for young women and young men, all right, who sometimes find themselves in difficult situations, and they don't know what to do. And Right to Life is an option. And so all the proceeds from the corsages today go to their ministry, and it's a wonderful gift. Shelly, would you stand up, please? Just stand up real quick, all right? Turn around. Model it for me. There it is, all right? Her daughter gave her one, all right? And they're there. You'll also find on the table when you come in from outside in the foyer, you'll find a table of bottles. And this is with Pregnancy Care Center. It says, life is precious. Pregnancy Care Center helps young moms and young dads, all right, make very good decisions. And also provides them with financial resources, all right, that helps with things like sometimes medical testing, diapers, formula. And so this is our way of being engaged with Pregnancy Care Center. This program is called Change for Babies. There's kind of a play on words there. You know, you need to change babies, all right, except this is change, pocket change, all right? You pick it up on Mother's Day, you bring it back by Father's Day. And the intent is you go home, you take the lid off. Every day you come in, you pull all the loose change out of your pocket, you fill the bottle up, and you bring it back by Father's Day, all right? And that works. That's what a lot of people do, all right? But there's other ways to do this. Number one, you can write a check and put it in here, all right? If you do write a check, it will tell you on here who to make the check to, Pregnancy Care Center, all right? And put it in the bottle and bring it back. The goal is Father's Day, but if you want to bring it back before Father's Day, that's okay. We, in fact, encourage you, drop it off before Father's Day, and here's why. You've heard me say this before, it's still true. The trends have not changed since last year. Father's Day is the lowest attendance of church every year, okay? So if you don't bring it back before Father's Day, it'll be late, okay? So you can bring it back before Father's Day. Now that I say that, next to Christmas and Easter, the largest Sunday of the year is Mother's Day. That's why we distribute them, all right, on Mother's Day. So you can pick them up on Mother's Day. Someday I have this great vision. We're going to break the trend at New Hope, all right? Hadn't happened yet, but I still have hope. So take one of these, fill it up, bring it back. You can also, aren't limited to checks or change. You can put bills in here, all right? $5 bill, $10 bill, $20 bill. Not your PG&E bill, not your AT&T bill. But you can put, you know, your bills in there, all right? And bring those back, and all that goes to Pregnancy Care Center. There is one clipboard going around on each side, and there's only one item on it. Coming up on May the 22nd is our evening pasta feed that we do every year. This is done annually in May, and this is to help our 5th and 6th graders go to camp. If you don't realize it, church camp has gotten really, really expensive, okay? High schooler kids camp, it's $515, okay? And our high school department has figured out a way to get that way, way down, all right? Kids can go up during winter camp weekends, and they can work a camp. And by the time all that gets tabulated in, we get those down to sometimes less than $200 for our high school kids because the kids invest into it. junior high camp, that's what our fireworks, all right, goes to and helps reduce that. They're $495 a week. Fifth and sixth graders are right up there in that same range. And so we try to make it as easy as we can on parents around here as possible. One of the ways to do that for fifth and sixth graders is a pasta feed. And so here's what you do. You put your name on here, you put your phone number, you put your email contact, and then you indicate what you're gonna, how you're going to help. And you can help in one of four ways or all four ways. Number one, I'll bring pasta. But only bring it if you cook it really good. Okay? We don't want lousy pasta. All right, bring good pasta. Okay? Number two, you can bring a salad. Number three, you can bring bread. Or you can bring pasta, salad, and bread. You can just indicate on what you're going to do. And then another way you can help is you can bring a gift card. And you're not limited. There's an example here of, you know, a $5, $10 Starbucks card. But someplace that you think, because this goes to raffles and in gift bags and things that will be used to raise funds. So one of them's full, but there's a sheet underneath it. The other one's about full. There's a sheet underneath it. Just please indicate that, and they will follow up with you. And this is on May the 22nd. Here's what I love about this. This is a pasta feed. We ask you to bring pasta, salad, bread, stuff that we're going to give away. And then we are going to sell tickets for you to come and eat the pasta and the salad and the bread that you brought, okay? This is really, really cool, all right? And we do this every year, and you keep doing it, all right? And it works really, really well. So thank you for that, all right? As that goes around, it really does make a difference, and kids' lives are changed as church camp. I am to announce that there is no Wednesday morning Bible study this week for the ladies. Okay, ladies, no Wednesday Bible study this week. It's not finished for the summer, just a break this week, okay? I understand Diana is out of town, so wanted to make that announcement for you. Let's see, I've highlighted that, I've taken care of that. Oh, this Tuesday, it is senior luncheon. If you are 55 or older, you can come to senior lunch. Even if you're still working, take your lunch break, come by, eat. It's potluck. If you've never been before, don't bring anything except yourself. The rest of you, you know the routine. You have a special guest this Tuesday, Jack Hanna. My former high school football coach, all right, is going to be here strumming his guitar and singing a few songs for you, all right? So that will be good this coming Tuesday. Baptism Sunday on May the 22nd. If you have not filled out a card indicating you want to be baptized and you would like to be, please do that today, all right, so we can follow up with you before that day. Widow's Lunch Bunch is going to meet on Sunday the 22nd as well. 22nd is going to be a very, very busy day. Let me highlight several prayer requests. Chris, our youth pastor, he went down on Friday to be with his brother who was getting his master's degree and graduating. And at that service, his dad is a pastor in Riverside. His dad has had a heart attack and open heart surgery multiple times. And his dad passed out during the service. They got him to the hospital. He is in ICU. He has had a small brain bleed. He is in stable condition. He's continuing to improve. Chris was there until late last night, got home very, very late. So please just be in prayer for Chris's dad. I know he'd appreciate that. Alec, young man we had prayer for a couple of weeks ago. Alec is about 10 years old. He's the Browns' grandson. That whole row, which is usually right in here, all right, they were in the 8 o'clock service today. They were there as a small group supporting the Ropes family. So there's two prayer requests there. Number one is Alec has had the one test this past week. He's a 10-year-old boy, got an appointment at Children's Hospital. He lives in Idaho now, but they could not get any specialists to see him until August. So his grandparents went and brought him here. Children's Hospital has jumped right on it. He had the test this past week where you have to drink that funny stuff at night and not eat anything. And yeah, he had that test last week. This coming week, they're going to go through the other end, and those two tests, they hope, will give them the results that they need to know how to begin to treat Alex. So please continue to be in prayer for him. And then that whole small group was at 8 o'clock because Arlene Brobst, a little over 48 hours ago, stepped into heaven at 7 a.m. Friday morning. She had had several months battle with cancer. Had a great visit with her the afternoon before we left. Was pretty confident that she would probably be in heaven before I got back home. And what a wonderful family, the great family in our church, regular attenders of our 8 o'clock, very active. Just 2 weeks ago, Arlene prepared food for a funeral reception. There was discussion of whether she should be asked, and Shelley said she signed up. That means she wants to do it. And when she was called, she said, absolutely. And Arlene's in heaven. Her husband, Jim, what a wonderful, sweet spirit this morning. I asked him how he's doing. He said, Tim, I'm perfect. He said, God has been so gracious through this process. So Arlene's service will be next Friday at 10:30 here at New Hope Church. Graveside will be at 9 a.m. at Clovis Cemetery. It is open to anybody who would like to come, but the service will be here at 10:30 with a reception to follow. Richard Brown, he and his wife are regular attenders here at New Hope. His mom had brain surgery this week on Wednesday, a large mass that was putting pressure on her optical nerve, and they were able to get 99% of the mass. And so they're very grateful for that. Jan Patton has improved significantly. It was my update I got from Steve on Friday, and so we are so grateful for that. The Friday before we left town, I got word that morning that one of our family's dearest friends, Jack Williams, passed away. Some of you will remember Jack. Jack's preached in this pulpit before. He was one of my mom's best friends. He thought my mom was his mom. His mom died when he was just a boy, and so when he came out to be a professor at California Christian College, one of my Bible college professors, one of my mentors, his name is on my ordination paper. He came out and preached mom's memorial service with us. Jack had a heart attack about 2 a.m. in the morning and died. And his services were this past Wednesday. So would appreciate you remembering his wife, Jana, so very much. When mom passed away, Shelley became the recipient of all of Jack's wonderful emails. Jack was a writer, and Jack wrote beautifully, and Jack was very encouraging. And in fact, Shelley and Jack talked more than Jack and I did. They were two or three times a week. We were two or three times a month. And Jack just had a way of lifting you up when you were down. And so I would appreciate it if you remember his wife, Janice. She has been so dependent upon him all of their married life. And my heart goes out to her and would appreciate you praying. I didn't know if I could do it time-wise in this service, but I'm going to do it anyway because I think I need to. Most of you know, Shelley and I were on vacation this past week. Probably the nicest weather we've ever had. We didn't have one argument the whole time that we were gone. That's pretty good for husband-wife vacations, isn't it? Not. We don't have one. But I was probably a Timmy Downer this past week. One, all that was going on here was weighing on me. But getting the news on Friday morning before we left Saturday morning that Jack had died. I got to be honest, there's no place I wanted to be more than I wanted to be in Nashville, Tennessee and be at Jack's memorial service. Besides my own dad, the two men who were most instrumental in my life did more for me than anybody else for long term, not just short term, but long term, were two men. One was Malcolm Fry, and Malcolm died, and his service was scheduled in Oklahoma same day that one of the young men who died in Iraq service was scheduled for. And there was no way I could be there. And I said, boy, when Jack's day comes, I'm going to be there. And Jack's day came, and it just, when we left, they didn't know when it was going to be scheduled. It might be 10 days away. It might be 7 days away. And when they called me on Monday and told me it was in 2 days, Shana already decided if it was going to be on Friday or Saturday, we would leave vacation and we would go there. Wednesday just wasn't going to happen. And I was bummed, and had a bit of a pity party. And Tuesday morning, after we got the news on Monday and knew I was probably worse than I was before, and we went for our morning walk right around sunrise. We'd like to go for a walk about a mile and a half on the beach. And as we take off on the beach, there is a lady sitting by herself in the sand on the beach, and she looks distraught. And as we walked by, Shelley said, I think I need to talk to her. And I said, okay. And she said, you know, I tell you what, we'll finish our walk as we come back. If she's still here, then I know I'm supposed to talk to her. Shelly cut our walk a little short that day, and we turned around and we headed back. And when we got fairly close, Shelly just made a beeline, and I went around. And Shelly got on her knees right in front of her and put her hands on her knees, and she introduced herself to her, and she said, is there anything I can do for you? And this lady started to cry more. And she said, oh, my husband died in January. And we already had this trip to Cabo planned. We've been coming for 20 years. We were coming with 5 other people. And I debated whether to come or not. And I knew it would be hard, but I didn't know it would be this hard. And so Shelly, they chatted for a while. And they asked if she could be with her. And she said, oh, she said, you are a godsend. This is a divine appointment. And they prayed. And they said they would find each other on the beach again over the next few days. And so we went at our same time every morning, and we never found her. Looked for her, stayed at the same place we were, and Shelly kept looking for her, never found her. Friday, it's mid-afternoon. We're poolside, and somebody comes over, and she says, oh, it's you. And she sat down, and they start talking, and they introduced me, and we got to visiting a little bit, found out her husband's name was Tim. And they'd been married over 31 years. And she then asked what I did. And I said, I'm a pastor. And she said, I knew it. And I said, oh, man, I hate it when it shows. and so we chatted some more, she said, I don't know if I should ask this, but she said, I've brought some of my husband's ashes. And I wanted, this was a favorite place, and I wanted to put them here, and my friends are going to join me. And she said, when I met Shelly, and I knew this was, she said, I was going to ask Shelly and you if you would join us, and maybe you could say a few words and pray. It was at that moment that, I can't tell you I got a lot happier, but it was at that moment I knew that God had us there for a reason. And it was more important than my reason being in Nashville. Because we knew Jack had a lot of encouragement, but there was a reason for Shelly to meet Jennifer. There was a reason for us to be there. And about an hour and a half after our visit there, she got everybody rounded up, and we headed down to the beach, and we walked out into the surf. Only time I was in the ocean all week, okay? And we walked down there, and she said, I know this is tacky. And she pulls it out, and he's in a Glad box. I looked at it, it made me laugh at that, but I said, what better box, man? Glad. I mean, he knew Jesus, okay? We knew this. He knew Jesus. So she opens up. She opens up the lid and places, you know, it in the water. We all stood in a circle and we joined hands and we prayed. And as she walked away, I thought, wow, what a difference in Jennifer on Friday than there was on Tuesday. And they've exchanged emails and addresses and phone numbers, and I won't be surprised, but you won't see Jennifer in church one of these days coming through on a visit. She lives in Southern California. But I simply share that with you because it really fits today's message as well, and I didn't know how to fit it into the message. So, and yet it does, that when we feel like things may not be good or going the way that we want them to go, but if we continue to trust God in those tough moments, He finds a way to bring good. He finds a way to give us a perspective that we might have missed otherwise. If Shelly hadn't have been sensitive to God's nudging at that moment, she would have missed a new friend. I would have missed an answer to why we were there. And I am just so very, very grateful for that today. Mm. Ushers, if you'll come forward, wait on us. We'll give thanks and get into our worship. Our Father, I love you. I love you because you're a God who cares. I love you because you're a God who's honest. You tell us in this world there's trouble, but you tell us you've overcome the trouble. You tell us in this world we'll experience sorrow, but hope will transform our sorrow into dancing. Father, your word tells us that when we know you, we will die, but yet shall we live. And so, Father, I just simply say thanks for who you are and what you have shared with us. I trust you with the needs that we've already expressed here today. You know intimately about more about them than we do. Trust you with the needs that have not been shared but are very important and personal to those who are sitting in our pews today. I pray for your touch, your voice in each of our lives today, and the time that we worship you in music and the time that we listen to you from the scriptures. May you find our hearts sensitive for what it is that you have to say to us. Thank you for meeting our needs. In Jesus' name, amen. Today we're going to be in Psalm 54. If you would like to turn there and be ready for that when we get there. There's kind of a parallel passage I'll be referring to if you want to write this one down or look at it some while we're going through it. It's 1 Samuel 23. 1 Samuel 23 are the events that unfolded that prompted David to write Song 54. We are in the midst of a series the entire year. It's called The Less More Lifestyle. It comes from the fact that most of us at the end of one year and the beginning of a new make a lot of resolutions. Things like, I want less weight and more shape. I want less debt, more savings. And what we're doing is taking that from the physical realm and the strictly secular realm and looking at it from an internal realm, our spiritual life. I want less guilt, more freedom. I want less pride and more humility. I want less fear and more trust. And for those of you who've been here from the beginning, you know I've left that kind of up to you to figure out. And I've even asked you to write down two or three things in the less, more thought process that you would like to see at the end of the year. And write that on a small piece of paper. Take a card in the pew if you haven't done it yet. And just think about that, whether it's during the sermon today or over the next few days. And write it down and tuck it in your Bible. Because when we get to December, we're going to pull those out. And we're going to do a little analysis. Hey, how's this year been? And in order to have a less more lifestyle, it requires a choice. It requires consistency with that choice. It requires accountability so that we maintain that choice that we've made. And then it also requires contemplation, that slow, steady, thoughtful process of investigating the Word of God. So the Word of God brings about the less more contrast that we desire in our life. Things like that kind of fit today's passage in the psalm. I'd like less revenge and more forgiveness. I'd like less jealousy and more appreciation. I'd like less anger, more love. You see, today's psalm has a lot to do with relationships. Our relationships with friends, our relationship with family, our relationship with superiors, our relationship with enemies. And what is it that God would like to do in us in regards to those kind of relationships that we have? I'm sure there are many of you here in the audience who are familiar with the daily cartoon that we no longer have in the newspaper, but it's the one I used to read first in the mornings. Peanuts. Okay, those of you who are under 30, okay, the only way you know Peanuts is because of the Christmas program, probably, or what, there's a amusement park that Peanuts is a big part of. Now, which one's that? Knott's Berry Farm, that's it. They didn't have Peanuts there when I was a kid, all right? So anyway, there was one particular cartoon that shared some of Charles Schulz's wisdom that I particularly like. It's the one where Lucy chides her little brother Linus, and she says, "You want to be a doctor?" That's a big laugh. You could never be a doctor. And you know why, Linus? Because you don't love mankind. That's why. Linus pondered the indictment of his older sister for a moment. And then, in a moment in the backyard alone, he shouts, "I love mankind! It's people I can't stand." I have heard pastors, not this one, but I have heard pastors say, "Ooh, Tim, I really love pastoring, except for some of the people." And probably every pastor has thought it. Whether we've said it or not, we've thought it. And let's be honest. Most of you can either laugh or cry, but you could say amen. Sometimes life would be a whole lot easier if it weren't for people. You see, nothing drains on us like the problems in our life of people who are difficult for us. And here's part of the issue. We all have difficult people in our lives, right? Don't look. Don't look right or left, okay? And there's not a one of us who think that we are ever the difficult person. And for somebody, we probably are. You see, the challenging circumstances of people problems are really hard on us because they impact us physically and emotionally and mentally and spiritually. Here's some words to prove my point. These are words that are associated with the challenging circumstances of people problems. And let me just start with the worst ones. Betrayal. Abuse. Abandonment. Neglect. Disappointment. Hurt. I want to take this to a quick application before we jump into the psalm. This is dangerous right now. If you have a piece of paper in your Bible, or even if you want to take a tithing envelope, okay, share it with that difficult person. I mean, share it with the person next to you. Small piece of paper. This is where it gets dangerous, because here I don't want anybody doing this. Okay, take a pen. And if you don't want to write it down, just think about it. I'm going to give you 15 seconds. Make a list in your mind or on paper of the two or three most difficult people in your life. Okay? Just take a moment to do that. You probably already have their names. If you don't have them already, they're not difficult. Those who are the difficult ones, man, they pop right into your head. Now, what I want you to do is, by that name, whether on paper or in your mind, write one word that describes your feeling about that person. Keep this private. We'll come back to this at the end. The name of the person and one word that describes your feelings about that person. All right. The title of this psalm. Remember, in every psalm, there's a title. Before verse 1, after the psalm, all right, there's always a short title. Sometimes it's just one sentence, you know, the director of music. Sometimes it tells you a little more. In Psalm 54, it tells you about as much as any particular psalm does. It says, "For the director of music with stringed instruments, a maskil of David, when the Ziphites had gone to Saul and said, 'Is not David hiding amongst us?'" See, David was playing hide-and-go-seek with Saul. And the place where David was hiding, he thought, was a trusted place. And the people that he trusted went to Saul and said, "We're going to show you where David's hiding." Betrayal. That is what prompted David to write this particular psalm. The circumstances are outlined for us in 1 Samuel chapter 23, verses 14 through 26, when the inhabitants of Ziph, and the inhabitants of Ziph were men of Judah. They betrayed David to Saul, as I just described. Remember, just a little history for those of you who haven't been here. David was just a shepherd boy when he was anointed to be the next king of Israel. Saul had betrayed God. And as a result, God said, the next king will not come from the family of Saul, but I'm going to choose my own king. And David was chosen. David then showed up at an army and he slew Goliath, and Saul met David for the first time, and Saul fell in love with David. He liked him like his own son, took him into his own home, into the castle. He loved it when David played his harp. It said it soothed his angry soul. And yet one day, while David was soothing his angry soul, Saul picked up a spear and threw it at David, tried to kill him. Not only did Saul betray David, but Saul became jealous of David because David became very popular among the people. David became his son's best friend, and Saul hated all of this going on, and so Saul pursued David in an attempt to kill him. And so David was hiding. And the people who lived in Ziph were men of Judah. What tribe was David's family from? It's a setup question. He's from the tribe of Judah. The inherited land given to the tribe is the area where David grew up. It was a stone's throw from Bethlehem. These are people that David grew up with. These are relatives of David's family. David thought if there was any safe place that I could hide, it would be with my own family, and I could find some rest and relief from this hunt that Saul has been on for my life. And it's those very people who run to Saul and say, hey, David's hiding over here. We'll show you. And David hears this. I can just picture David. He's dirty and he's sweaty and he's hungry and he's thirsty and he's exhausted. And no doubt he's extremely now discouraged by betrayal. And he slumps by a bush or in the shadow of a rock and he begins to pour out his feelings in a poem. He's attacked and betrayed by people that he trusted and believed in. And he's now led by the Holy Spirit of God to record his feelings. And these expressions are what we have recorded right here in Psalm 54. Let me read it. Follow along with me if you would, please. Save me, O God, by your name. Vindicate me by your might. Hear my prayer, O God, and listen to the words of my mouth. Strangers are attacking me. Well, what he's really saying is here, people I thought I know, I don't know. I thought they were family and friends, but no, they treat me like strangers. Ruthless men seek my life, men without regard for God. Surely God is my help, and the Lord is the one who sustains me. Let evil recoil on those who slander me, and in your faithfulness destroy them. I will sacrifice a free will offering to you. Dad, look, Free Will Baptists were the first Baptists mentioned in the Bible. Right there. I will sacrifice a free will offering to you. I will praise your name, O Lord, for it is good. For he has delivered me from all of my troubles, and my eyes have looked in triumph on my foes. That word triumph is also translated in two or three other versions as satisfaction. I have looked with satisfaction on my enemies. This psalm was short and sweet, written by David after he had been delivered at the last minute from destruction. From all outward appearance, it looks as if David was cornered. It seems that every possible avenue of escape had been closed. It seems that his back is against the wall and destruction is upon him. But aren't you glad? Aren't you glad there is a God who can make a way when there seems to be no way? Just as Saul was about to catch David. You can go back to 1 Samuel 23 and read this. A messenger was sent to Saul. He's got David cornered. And a messenger comes to Saul and says, Saul, come quick! The Philistines are about to destroy Jerusalem. And Saul has to take his army that he's used to try to capture one man, and he's got to take them all the way back so he can protect his country and his home. When a person has been saved from certain destruction, whether it's physical or spiritual, there is a reason to praise God. And that is why David wrote this particular psalm. It has him at his worst in verses 1 and 2, and it has him at his best in verses 6 and 7. You see, in verses 1 through 3, we find the prayer. And in verses 4 through 7, we find the answer. Aren't we glad we have a God who answers prayer? A God that delivers us out of the dangerous places. You see, David goes from trouble to triumph. David goes from problems to praise, from running to rejoicing, from being scared to being safe, from praying to praising, from sighing to singing, from worrying to worship, from death to deliverance, from victim to victor. Aren't you glad we serve a God who turns our circumstances around? Three things I want us to notice. Number one, David calls out to God in time of trouble. David calls out to God in times of trouble. Here we see David in verses 1 through 3 calling on God to get him out of trouble. Somebody said, prayer is the salve for every sore and the relief for every hurt. The trouble was unnatural that David was going through. Keep in mind, these were David's own relatives, his own countrymen. He's sad indeed. It's sad when a man's friends become like foreigners. His friends were treating him like the enemy. The king he had once fought for is now fighting him. Like the Apostle Paul, David was in perils in the midst of his brethren. It's been said the people you love the most will what? Hurt you the worst. The people you love the most hurt you the worst. It's absolutely correct. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him would not perish but have everlasting life. God loved us so much that a perfect son who had never felt the pain of sin in his soul, the scripture says, became sin. He loved us so much, those he loved so much hurt him so bad, it cost him his life. These Ziphites were pretending to be David's friends. Jesus gave a warning that watch out for wolves who come in sheep's clothing. A false friend may become a fierce enemy. Saul loved David as long as David was doing what Saul wanted, but jealousy drove him mad to the point that he was seeking to kill a valuable soldier of his own army. Not only was this trouble unnatural, but it was unmerciful. Nothing less than the death of David was going to satisfy Saul. Sometimes in relationships, we think nothing but the destruction of somebody else is going to satisfy our frustration. He could not rest as long as David was alive, even though David had done no wrong to him. This is often the attitude of a depraved mankind. Kill those that do good. Jesus Christ went about doing good, and yet who was it that crucified him? Those he had come to seek and to save. 2 Timothy 3, verses 1 through 5 says that mankind can become the despisers of those that are good. The trouble was also ungodly, along with being unmerciful and unnatural. Ungodly means not to have God in front of your eyes. It means to speak or act without concern for God. It means to do as you please without any regard to what God thinks about what you're doing. To act as if God cannot see, to speak as if God cannot hear, to live as if God can't do anything about your circumstances. Verse 3, it says, men without regard for God. I don't know about you, but it sounds an awful lot like the country we're living in right now. When men and women come to a place of ignoring God, we trample on morals, on conscience, on justice, and on self-respect. Observe that David's requests of deliverance and vindication, he makes this request on the basis of two things. This is verse 1. Save me, O God, by your name. At the name of Jesus, every knee will bow. And every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Number 2, vindicate me by your might. You see, David appeals to the power and the name of God. When attacked by others, we often begin to think they have unlimited power over us. And David finds comfort in the protective, powerful name of Jesus. Number 2, David not only calls out in trouble, but he finds comfort in the one to whom he calls. Verses 4 and 5. David, in this time of despair, remembers an important truth. He remembers that he is on God's side. Important principle here. God is not on our side. Okay? I didn't choose God. I accepted God. God chose me. So I didn't choose God to play on my team. God chose me. God chose you to be part of his family. It's important for us to understand. David said in another passage, God is my helper. Probably the best way to say that, what David means is, God's fighting this thing for me. When the child of God is hemmed in by circumstances and people, as David was, there's only one thing to do. Look up. You see, to look within ourselves just brings more discouragement. That's what I did for a couple of days last week. It wasn't really because of difficult people. And yet, if I stayed within myself, you know the thoughts I was thinking? Why didn't Jack's family think about my schedule when they set this service date? That's looking in, and the discouragement grows. When we look around, we end up disappointed. But when we look up, we find delight. Psalm 50, verse 15 says, call upon me in the day of trouble, and I will deliver you. That's exactly what David did. He called out to God, save me by your name. Save me is the cry of physical deliverance. This was the cry of Peter when he was sinking beneath the waves. David said, by your name, save me. God's name stands for his nature and his attributes. God is a God of power. Psalm 20, verse 7 says, some trust in chariots and some in a horse, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God. He's more powerful than chariots and horses. Proverbs 18, 10 says, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. I think we sing about that, don't we? A strong and mighty tower. The righteous run into it. And what are we? Safe. Safe. Twice David declares, God is. That's in verse 4. Surely God is my help. The Lord is the one who sustains me. You and I need this faith that has as its life God himself. David knew the presence of God in his situation. He had learned to live above the circumstances of life simply by resting in the promises of God. And the quality of faith, this quality of faith, has made many common men and women into heroes of faith. And if you don't believe that, read Hebrews chapter 11 and read about the men and women who were there, who were as common as you and I are in life, but because of faith in God himself, they became heroes of faith. David chooses to leave vengeance to God. Notice verse 5. Let evil recoil on those who slander me. In your faithfulness, destroy them. Sounds pretty tough, doesn't it? But what David is saying here is, God, this is up to you. It's not up to me. And we know that was true in David's life because if you then read chapters 24, 25, 26, and 27 of 1 Samuel, you will find on multiple occasions where David could have taken Saul's life, and not once did he. David said, I'll not raise my hand against God's anointed. Though I am to be the next king of Israel, I will not rush to sit on a throne. I will wait for God's timing. I will endure hardship and wait and not take matters into my own hand. David, though the passage had not been written, David understood the principle that Paul addressed in Romans chapter 12, verses 17, 18, and 19, when Paul said, never pay back evil for evil to anyone. So when is it okay to repay evil for evil? And to whom can you pay evil to evil back to? Nobody. Never anyone. Respect what is right in the sight of all men, if possible, as far as it depends on you, not on anybody else but you. Be at peace with all men. David illustrated how you can be at peace even with those trying to take your life. Remember the story, Saul? Remember Saul needed to use the bathroom and he goes into the cave? David cuts just a corner off of his tunic And when Saul goes back outside with the rest of the soldiers, David came to the mouth of the cave and he waved that piece and he said, "Saul, I could have taken your life, but I will not. That's God's business." David did not repay evil for evil. He respected what was right in the sight of all men. As it depended upon him, he wanted to live with peace with Saul. Never take your own revenge, beloved. Beloved, he softens this. Never take revenge, beloved. But leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord." Here's the kicker, guys. Those that we want revenge on, God wants to redeem. And God will pursue them for redemption. And if they reject his redemption, they will end up with his vengeance. Leave it in his hands. With the understanding, because it just might be your attitude in this moment that God wants to use for their transformation. With the understanding that the burden of vengeance, with the understanding that the frustration of winning this battle, with the understanding that the aggravation of proving yourself is no longer David's responsibility, David is now able to do the third thing this chapter does, and he's able to sing. David begins to sing. He calls out to God in his time of trouble. He finds comfort in turning to God. And once he has rested in the one he's turned to, he now begins to rejoice in deliverance. Verses 6 and 7. Only faith in God can let a person rejoice in the midst of their troubles. The most we can do is trust God in the middle of our problems. The least we can do is to praise God after he delivers us. Where there is no trouble, there is no triumph. A runner cannot win if there is no race. Nyquist could not have won the Kentucky Derby. I got the name right? If there had been no Kentucky Derby. A climber cannot reach the top if there is no mountain. A farmer cannot eat an ear of corn without the sweat of planting it. A boxer cannot win unless there is a fight. And a Christian will not appreciate victory if there has been no battles. Many times God allows burdens in our lives to let us know that he is able to handle them. None can praise the Lord so well of those who have been tried and proved God's faithfulness in their hour of desperation. David's not literally out of trouble yet, but notice his certainty of deliverance. He puts future redemption in past tense. He hath delivered. Mine eyes hath seen. Faith sees future as the present. Tell me that does not bring hope to Jim Bropst today, whose wife died Friday morning at 7 o'clock, and yet today he knows she lives. And he knows that in the future, he will be with her again. That's what hope in God does. Faith sees the glory of the future in the gloom of the present. And notice the change of perspective and attitude from verses 1 to verses 6 and 7. He goes from despondent to rejoicing. How about you and I declare war on those long-standing habits that we cultivate against each other? How about let's declare war on negative feelings, on unforgiveness, on resentment, on competitiveness, on grudges, on revenge, on jealousy, on hatred, on gossip, on criticism, on suspicion? Let's leave that ugly road behind forever. Let's choose another path, one that Jesus blazed for us, one that's called the road of love. Once Christ is in our focus, it's amazing how powerful his love can be to us, how incredible his love can be for us, and how mighty his love can be through us when we can even love those who might persecute us. How beautiful, I'm going to wrap this up, how beautiful Amy Carmichael reminds us of this in her small but penetrating book called If. This book came out almost 40 years ago. I remember the book when it showed up at the Bible House. It was a little skinny book, about that wide and about that tall. Two big long letters on it, I and F, and Amy Carmichael's name right across the bottom. I thought to myself when it showed up, this book will never sell. And it became a blockbuster, and people still quote in it in their books today. Let me read just an excerpt of her insights about what will happen if we let God be God, and what will happen if we don't let God be God. If I belittle those whom I am called to serve, I talk of their weak points in contrast, perhaps, with what I think are my strong points. If I adopt a superior attitude, forgetting who made thee to differ, and what hast thou that thou hast not received? If that be true of me, then I know nothing of Calvary's love. If I take offense easily, if I am content to continue in cool unfriendliness, though friendship be possible, then I know nothing of Calvary's love. If I feel bitterly towards those who condemn me, as it seems to me unjustly, forgetting that if they knew me as I know myself, they would condemn me much more, then I know nothing of Calvary's love. In times of trouble, the child of God can keep rejoicing through faith in God that we know will deliver us. No matter what the circumstances, He is God. He does not change. All right, pull out your list. That short list of difficult people. For each name, here's what I'd like you to do. For each name you have there, determine how God might use him or her as a means of making you better. See, this is putting into reality Romans 8:28. For all things work together for good to those who love God. Can you not think that that verse is appropriate if we translate it this way? For all people work together for good in your life if you love God? How might the Lord use this person to transform our character? This does not excuse their poor behavior. It merely acknowledges the faithfulness of God in every one of our circumstances. And when we can do that, we can then do two more things for the name on that list, which will make all the difference in the world. Number one, we can offer pardon to them. We can give pardon. And do you know how freeing it is to stop carrying the grudge and the anger and the animosity? And as we give pardon, we can now genuinely pray for them. Here's what I've discovered. It's hard for me to stay mad at somebody when I pray for them. It's hard for me to continue to be angry when I'm praying for them. It's hard for me to stay angry when I'm praying to God about me. And I stop being so mad at me. Because sometimes we are our own worst enemy. And what we offer to ourselves, maybe, this is what Jesus meant when he said, love the Lord your God with all your might, with all your heart, with all your soul, and love your neighbor as you love yourself. And when we can pray and forgive and pardon ourselves, we are making the next step to forgive and pardon and move on with others. Let's pray. Father, I'll be honest, I did not think this was a psalm that I would have preached on in this series at the beginning of it. It's one I really rushed by and skipped through, but Father, I'm so glad you brought me back to it. Thank you for what you want to teach each of us about our relationships with others in this world. It's an old movie that describes this world as the good, the bad, and the ugly. And all of us think we're the good, and we have to put up with the bad and the ugly. When the reality is, there's a bit of all three. There's enough of all three to go around for every one of us. And so, Father, I pray that we will turn to the one who truly is good, and we will let you deal with the bad and the ugly in us and in those around us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.